Through few slides. This is the CIMS webinar team. Today we'll be having a special session for the postgraduate students, and especially for the ones it will be beneficial for the ones who will be appearing for the exams now. Then we have upcoming webinar on practical approach in management of odontogenic cysts. Well, this is regarding the QR code of CIMS YouTube channel. So please subscribe and don't forget to hit the bell icon so that whatever videos are uploaded, you'll get a notification about that. And also please do like us on Facebook. That's all from my side. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Now we hand it over to Varsha to conduct the proceedings. Varsha Manekar is our secretary of the association, a very dynamic secretary. Brinda is the treasurer and Abhilasha is the webinar coordinator. Varsha, can you conduct the meeting, please?
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Good morning to one and all. Today is 23rd July 2020. Myself, Dr. Varsha Manekar, the secretary of CIMS, welcome each one of you for this webinar exclusively for the exam-oriented postgraduates. Good morning to Dr. Ashish Gupta, Dr. Rai, my friend Dr. Mukul, Dr. Saji Thomas, eminent participants, and which gives honor to us, Dr. S.K. Menon, Dr. Deva, Dr. Pritam Shetty, Dr. Ashok Devi. I welcome all the eminent personalities and our participants. The participants are our strength. Central India Academy of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery had a tremendous response in our last two series, where we have done with 32 webinars, including the Women's Webinar Week. And today is all main team. So today is all main day. Starting with the third new series of webinars, this is the 33rd webinar. With a careful analysis of the responses which we got from the participants, the topics were selected, and this is one of the topics which has been asked by our participants. Our team, Dr. Shenoy, who is president, Dr. Vrinda Kolte, Dr. Madhumati Dhawar, Dr. Abhilasha, we all work hand in hand to reach at this juncture. Now, coming to the next feather in our cap is, we are live on both YouTube and Facebook. So we are having we can accommodate more participants in this webinar. Most of our webinars are going in-house. We are having participants from our country as well as outside the country. Our speakers like Dr. Asero, Dr. Prabhu from London, and all our eminent national speakers, they have shared their experience with us, with all the participants, and that is the reason why these webinars are the success. Today, as I said, it is the 23rd webinar on the topic of the viva voce, and our own president, Dr. S.R. Shenoy, is the moderator of this webinar. He has 23 years of experience as an academician and as an administrator and a clinician. He is a PG guide and a PhD guide as well. He is my PhD guide. I am his PhD scholar. And he has more interest in facial pain and trauma. But he, as you all know, if you have listened to him at all platforms with many, what you call, I'm not saying webinars, many physical sessions of the scientific endeavors. He is expert in MPA and Chhattisgarh PSC. And he has number of publications to his credits. He has organized many conferences and continuing education programs. He is currently on national and state AMSI, and he is president of our CIMS. I welcome Dr. Shenoy as a moderator. Now I hand over the proceedings to Dr. S.R. Shenoy.
Thank you, Varsha, those kind words. I don't know whether I'm worthy because so far I have not got a platform to speak on my own association. So because we choose only eminent people, and possibly that is one of the reasons why I couldn't be there. Good morning, everybody. Respected members, I could see Dr. Suresh Menon, Dr. S.K. Diwan, Dabir sir, and many, many more. My friend, dear friend, Preetam, who's joined, and I'm sorry if I can't name everybody because I've not seen the list yet. Today is a very special day because, as Dr. Varsha said, that we have been working on these webinars based on inputs that we get from the residents, basically. So we thought, why not have something that most of the PGs are worried about, you know, how to face the viva. And for this, we got four very eminent academicians in the country. They're great clinicians also. They have got an astute knowledge about everything. So that is why we had Ashish, Dr. Bhagwan Das, Mukul, and Dr. Shaji. So beginning with Ashish, Ashish has been a very reticent guy as far as giving his biodata is concerned. So, but from what I know of him, he's a very astute clinician, academician. He's got innumerable publications and talks to his credit. I shared recently the masterclass platform at Faridkot, and he speaks very incisively. He is the professor and head of Sudha Rustagi Dental College, Faridabad. Dr. Bhagwan Das Rai, who did from A.B. Shetty Memorial, his BDS from A.B. Shetty and MDS from Bakuji Dental College. And it's a matter of great pride for us that he is the president, that is vice chancellor of Pacific Academy of Higher Education and Research, Udaipur. He is a PG and PhD guy. I always call him whenever I have some issue, some administrative or some academic issue. I always call upon Bhagwan, and he is like an advisor to us. He's got innumerable publications and research projects to his credit. He is the past honorary secretary of the AMSI Rajasthan chapter. He is currently a EC member of AMSI, that's the national one. He has been the vice president and president of IDA Udaipur and Rajasthan. He was elected under Section 3C to the Dental Council of India. He's been a past member of Board of Studies of Ramaya University of Applied Sciences, Bangalore, member of Sumandeep University, UG's Board of Studies at JSS Mysore, and currently member of Curriculum Reforms of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery. Dr. Mukul Pathe, a very close friend of mine, though by chronology he joined PG later than me, but then I think both of us consider that he is my teacher. So Mukul is currently the Dean Faculty at D.Y. Patil Dental College, Navi Mumbai. He has held various positions at National State AMSI. He's got special interest in orthognathic surgery, TMJ, and implants, and has got more than 100 publications and has been faculty at various conferences, workshops, and symposia. Dr. Shaji Thomas, the guy who looks like Akbar, I believe. He did his BDS and MDS from Bakuji Dental College, Davangir. He's got innumerable achievements to his credit. He's the principal of PG Bhopal, PG Guide. He is on the editorial board of reputed journals and has innumerable publications. He has delivered guest lectures at many forums. And basically, all of them, what I consider as my achievement, is that they're great friends of mine. So I welcome them all. And we are live on Facebook. Okay. This will be delayed. will be put up delayed on YouTube also. Because basically we have a limitation of getting it restreamed on YouTube also. So what I would like to begin is by, you know, when we talk about viva voce, you know, sometimes, you know, the best of the students, they get nervous. And that is for the same reason that we decided to have, talk, a panel discussion on how the students can face the viva very confidently. So I'll just share the screen and then we'll start the presentation. So welcome to all the honorable panelists for this talk, right? And what I would appeal to all the students the residents is that, you know, you got to keep calm, right? Because maxillofacial surgery is something where you always need to keep calm, right? There could be tricky situations that happen so many times, and we need to attend it very confidently, very boldly. So it's no, you know, nothing different. An exam is nothing different. You just have to go there, be confident, and face the examiner. Now, I would like to begin with the exam pattern. This is, I think, it's slightly, I mean, it's more or less the same everywhere. Am I right, Dr. Bhagwan Das?
This is the This is the DCA format.
Yes. This is the DCI format. So it's not going to be different for, I mean, any university in India, right? So of course, what happens is that in some universities there are two cases, case discussions. But Viva essentially is 100 marks where you got a differentiation within that. That is
80.
Yes.
80-20.
And you have the Viva OC now separately. Okay. So this is the scheme of exams that is there all over India. Right. Now, what happens is, if we begin with the first part, that is case presentation, I would like to bring in here Ashish about a particular thing. Ashish?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what that we are looking for in a case discussion?
Sir, is it the clinical case, minor surgery, what we are looking at right now?
We are looking at the long cases. The minor surgery would come a little later.
Minor surgery. Okay. So we will be looking at the long case now first. So if it is a long case, it will be for 60 marks, I think. And this long case will include everything. It has to be demography. Then you have to have your clinical examination. Your chief complaint. So long case means it will be dealt with full history taking. Then you have to reach to a provisional diagnosis. And if you have these investigations beforehand, then you have to show them. Or if you do not have investigations, then we would be looking at you to tell us what investigations do you want to go for to reach to the final diagnosis. And this will include full medical history of the patient, full clinical examination, that will be physical examination of the body as such, and then our own interesting area like oral cavity, extraoral, intraoral. So what we will start with, full demography, then chief complaint, history of present illness. History of present illness should include everything. There should not be any lacuna in between. And then we have to have our clinical examination, that will be our physical examination, and then medical history. Medical history should be dealt with in details, and then our examination part. And after that, we will be seeing the investigations. Sir.
Bhagwan. How relevant is there in the long case or the short case history? If suppose we give a short case, right? The importance of medical history.
Pardon? Hello?
Yeah, the significance of medical history.
Yes, significance of medical history. If there is any comorbidities, if it is there, we need to identify, or any underlying metabolic, any other condition, we need to be aware before we take up. It's not the particular case. If it is just, if you, for example, if it is a trauma case or a pathology case that needs a surgery, but the medical history is very important, underlying medical condition. Without knowing that, we just can't go ahead and proceed with the surgery, because the fitness of the surgery has to be seen. The antibiotic coverage has to be seen. So all these things are covered in the medical history. So I would like to say, if the 60 marks question is there, we can divide it into as a case history, as case history part with 10 marks, investigation as 10 marks, the differential diagnosis as 10 marks, the treatment planning of around 20 marks, and the final discussion of around 10 marks. That sums up to the whole case history part. So we need to see that how much each part has and time which is allotted, the 30 minutes. So how we are going to distribute. So everything is important, whether it's a medical history or the investigation part. So we cannot, any student cannot sit on only one section of it thinking that this is the only important aspect. So medical history is an important aspect, it has to be. And at the same time, if the patient has earlier prescriptions or any of the treatment done, that also has to be taken into account, that has to be reviewed and seen at present, is he under any medication or on non-medication. So all these things has to be reviewed in that case history and past medical history.
Okay. Mukul, Dr. Pate? Mukul, we always tell, you know, in an exam, we tell them to take relevant points. So what are these relevant points that you want?
Yeah, in fact, I was coming to that very nicely spoken by Ashish and Bhagwan. However, I want to make one point. See, when you have a long case, a case history for a trauma will be different from a cancer case, will be different from an orthognathic case. So once you know what case it is, then you have to dwell more into detail on that particular case. You can't have the same history and examination which you'll have for a you know, an oncology case and a orthognathic case. So your total examination, clinical examination will differ and change. So you have to modify your particular examination and presentation depending on the type of case you have. What holds good for one may not go to hold good for the other, you know. Like in orthognathic surgery, your facial analysis or your clinical analysis will hold far more importance than what you'll see in a oncology case. In oncology case, your neck examination will hold more importance than vis-a-vis a trauma case. So all these things, I think the students much individually, for a particular case, depending on what it is, and go about in detail examination regarding that, is what I feel. And I feel one more thing, which is, you have to stick to your time limit also. You know, many times every examiner normally likes to give a time or to a stipulated time for a particular case. So that is the same for a short case and a long case. And each university has their own stipulation. I think half an hour is given for this long case, if I'm mistaken. So I think in that particular half an hour, you must be able to, you can't say I couldn't reach this particular stage of examination because I took more time in history, you know. So this is what I feel. Many times students ask irrelevant questions which are not required for a particular case. This is what I feel.
Correct.
Like habits and all these things will be more important in an oncology case, or you know, or your history of trauma, your type of the accident and your possibility of head injury is much more important in a trauma case than vice versa. So depending on your case, you must tailor make your particular history and examination is what is important.
Yeah, Shaji, one thing, you know, sometimes it's not possible that, especially when you have so many students who are appearing, and it may be difficult, you know, at that particular point of time to have unoperated cases. So there could be a situation where we have an operated case. Let us, for example, we say that we have a case of an operated case of temporomandibular joint, a recently operated case of temporomandibular joint, right? So, Shaji, what is your take on that? If you have an operated case, how would you go about taking the history?
Basically, when we take history, we are looking at what the patient needs into the future. So, when we talk about what the patient has already had that particular surgery, for example, an ankylosis patient who probably got operated for release of his ankylosis, that patient's next need is to look better. So, the case history will go towards facial deformity correction rather than the ankylosis which is actually performed. Of course, a short presentation that the patient underwent ankylosis surgery would have to be there. But then the students in the clinicians see, basically when you look at case history, we are looking at something that, you know, a student will do in his usual practice. Okay, so when you look at ankylosis, the student needs to see what else the patient needs so as to, you know, have a full life. So at that point of time, probably the patient needs this facial aesthetic correction and things like that. So they need to take case history in that line.
Okay. No, but that is as far as temporomandibular joint is concerned, ankylosis is concerned. But, you know, sometimes you may just have a facial trauma patient. Then in that case, how do you look to the future, Bhagwan?
No, regarding that case, I wanted to just add on certain points. See, that case, while discussing, the student should understand during the discussion part of it. He would have done the case history, investigation, diagnosis, everything. But when the discussion comes, the discussion will move in two directions. Either if there is a deformity, why the deformity was not corrected before the release of joint. So this particular aspect the student should think of. So during discussion, the concentration of the discussion will be on surgery first, the correction first, and release of joint later. Or in the particular case probably which is allotted, the release of the joint has taken place, further the correction of the deformity is being taken. So this angle has to be thought, and he should be prepared for both the aspect of it. If it is an operated case which has been given. So always this aspect will be considered, and that is an important point where the student needs to be prepared for that. If he is not prepared for it, deformity correction, so distraction and this aspect I will be talking, or orthomorphic surgery which need to be done, chin correction will be done, that alone will not suffice. So he should be aware of the previous part of the discussion will move in the retrograde direction of the release of the joint also. It might go to the etiology part of it also. So it ranges. If it is an operated case, as Dr. Shahji told, it doesn't move only on the forward direction. It will move in the backward direction during the discussion part. So that, because it's a major case.
Basically, no, Rama. I just have a point to add.
Yeah.
As a student, when you come across such a case that an operated case of ankylosis was given, it will be prudent of the student to politely ask the examiners, what aspect would you like to case history about, and then follow that, because the examiners already have something in their mind. And it will be prudent for the student to ask the examiner, sir, would you like me to take the history of the case that the operated part, or would you like to me to take the history further?
And, yeah. That is not possible for the student. I think that is the role of the internal examiner. Please, yeah, I don't think a student can actually ask an examiner, what do you want me to take history on?
Yeah.
I think the internal will play that role of what... see, basically, yeah. In any case history, I feel the student should understand that the examiner wants to know the knowledge of that particular case, you know, whether he is able to reach a diagnosis and reach a treatment planning for that particular case.
Okay. There is one question already, and before I go to that question, my request to the audience would be that, you know, please put questions pertaining to this particular viva, this particular session. You know, we cannot ask questions about a particular case. You know, like I got a question, I'm very sorry, like whether you'd use this interpositional graft or so on and so forth, that is not, because then this session will not end at all, okay? Because oral surgery is so just pertaining to the topics that we are going to deal, that we'll talk, right? Ashish, I was anyway coming to you. Ashish, you're muted.
I'll add one point to it.
Yeah.
If it is an operated case,
yeah.
I think Bhagwan sir has nailed it correctly, that the student has to be ready for both the things, that what case was it, the diagnosis of that case, and what after that. So both the things a student should take history for, a little of that and little of that, so that examiner, if he asked about the case, what was the case, how did you diagnose that case, he should be ready for that. And what in future you need to know about this case, that what all are you going to do in future about it.
Right.
So I think it is a combination of both the things that student has to be ready for.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Ashish. There was one question which I think Ashish answered. What if, should we take a negative history?
Pardon?
Negative history. Should we take a negative history? I mean...
I will go for negative history in long case. I will not go for any sort of negative history in the short cases.
Huh.
Because of time constraint, sometimes negative history is important, and that we will take it in long case. I would not ask any student to take any negative points in the short case. Short case should be only positive finding, and what diagnose, how you diagnose, and what you are going to do about.
What is negative history, Rama, if I may ask?
Example, patient does not have icterus pallor. You know, I think that should be. Achha. Yeah. Mukul, I was coming.
Examination, you mean, on negative history?
Part of the case history going stepwise. So like each and everything.
History. This comes in examination. Icterus pallor will be what we see.
General physical examination.
Yeah. So negative physical examination. Okay.
Okay. One question which makes me go back, you know, is that, you know, we talked about operated cases. So there is one question that has just come up, that we talked about ankylosis, where we can say that, you know, we'll talk about its reconstruction or rehabilitation. What happens if the operated case is a trauma case? The operated case is a case of trauma. Then what?
Yeah.
It's cool answering or may I?
No, Ashish answer.
Yeah, okay.
For me, it is not the operation, but I would like the student to know about the physical findings and the x-rays what were used before the operation or surgery. And what history was there, why that history was important, like clinical examination, history of illness, about the head injury was there or not. So I would take that history or a case examination as if it is not operated. Then we will take it later on that how it has been operated, what you thought that it should have been operated, or how it has been operated. Is it been operated according to you, what you wanted, or is something different? But I will take history to the pre-operative stage of this case.
And now we come to, we've already discussed the long cases. Mukul, beginning with you, short case.
Yeah.
Relevant points. So
In short case, see, at an MDS examination, where the examiner wants to know, you should be able to delete whatever information which is not important, and only the pointers towards your diagnosis in a short case. So you don't necessarily go, you know, dwell into the entire details of the history. And most of the time, the short cases are small cases, like a cyst or, you know, some mucous fibrosis, something of that sort. So it is very important that you talk just the pointers which you reach the diagnosis, rather than going into the depth of history, how you do for a long case. This is how normally we have taken our this. And the idea is to develop a discussion when the viva takes place for that particular case. So it's not necessary that the history has to be perfect or what you write down has to be perfect, but you should be able to talk to the patient, examine the relevant positive findings, and talk that when the examiner asks you the questions on that particular case.
Bhagwan?
Yeah. See, as I told, the long case, see, distributing the marks is an equal thing, so that we can think of taking the history accordingly. So it is 15 minutes for a minor case usually. So it is 20 marks question. 20 marks allotted for each minor case. If it is two minor case, plus 40. So based on that, you can distribute it for here. If you see, you can distribute 4 marks for case history, then investigation another 4 marks, then differential diagnosis marks, management planning or the treatment planning another 4 marks, and discussion will be another 4 marks. So you divide into 4 into 5 parts of this. And then if you have taken only the positive findings, then the discussion will revolve around that. And it is by and large, as it has been told, more of a spot diagnosis like thing. It will be mainly the salient features which will be asked, their observation in shortest span of time, main investigations which have been done. Suppose if it is a cyst case, what all things will you do? Suppose if it is an OKC, you would like to ask for the aspiration, what type of an aspiration you will expect. Even after aspiration coming, seeing the color, would you like to go for any further investigation of that aspiration? So very, very briefly, these things the student should be aware of if it is in a minor case. There won't be a big, long discussion. It's a very small discussion which will take place.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, I just want to know, I really don't know whether Bhagwan very nicely said that you divide, but I don't know how many of us actually do this division while taking the examination, you know, whether you divide 4 marks for differential diagnosis, 3 marks for diagnosis. I really, the overall is to talk to the student and find out, you know, this is what I feel.
No, what I'm telling is, as a student, if he divides this, so he will also be concentrating. Yes, in history, I'll be concentrating on this part. Investigation, yes, I have to concentrate. I'll note down this is his part. Differential diagnosis, yes, this is my treatment plan. And this is, I'll leave it for the discussion. That's if the student plans it that way, then it becomes easy. Evaluators, of course, if they divide like this, then the evaluation becomes easier. Yes, in the history part, yes.
Examination of the evaluators ho jayega fir.
Can I say a line?
Yes.
To sum it up, what I feel, student for the short case should be positive clinical findings along with some medical history points, and then provisional diagnosis with investigations. That is all. What we look at, I look at these four things only. If it is a short case, because 15 minutes means 15 minutes. So this is how we divide it into four: medical history, positive clinical findings, a provisional diagnosis with the investigations further, which you want. And then you can take up the discussion for treatment and anything. But as far as student is concerned, we need four things from the student at the time of history taking.
Okay. Shahji, one last word before we go to the next.
I agree with what Ashish said. That's perfectly right. What basically is expected from the student is he able to, in general surgery, there is something called a spot diagnosis. So is he able to actually recognize a patient with a problem in a spot way? So, to quickly, a clinician doesn't have the time to sit and take these detailed cases unless there is something serious. Most clinicians are required to take decisions in 15 minutes of spending time with the patient. So basically the whole idea of this short case history is to identify smaller diseases that can be quickly decided upon, and to separate the longer cases like the cancer and the orthopedic, which requires integrated planning, to separate them to long case histories and save his time at the clinical table. So it is a very good, I think what they should really concentrate on, like Ashish says, concentrate on the positive points, get the summary of the case right, and arrive at preferably at a diagnosis, or if not at a differential diagnosis, which can be ruled out.
Okay.
Thank you.
So now we go to the third point. I think the third point is, yes, records and albums. So these are certain things, like, how relevant would that be to an examiner, Mukul?
Yeah. Okay, for me, actually speaking, I'll give less importance to the album. Record keeping is important because that trains you for further about keeping records in your own private practice also. But my only suggestion or my only advice to the students is, when you make an album, don't unnecessarily lie about cases, or don't put in cases which you have not done. The examiners are not, toothpiche bachche. So they understand what you would have done and what is the scope in your particular institute of how much you can do yourself. So when you keep albums, make sure that you make them an honest attempt at making an album, rather than putting in all the cases which have been done in the last 10 years, which you may not have been a part of also. So this is my record keeping. Yes, is important.
Yeah. So, just continuing with what Mukul said, as an examiner, I just want to know what you have done. It doesn't matter that if you have an album putting apicectomies or mucoceles or intermaxillary fixations, that doesn't matter. I don't want to see that you have operated cancer when I know that you have not operated. So, even if it is a smaller impaction case which you have put in album, I just want to know that how you prepare it. How do you keep your records intact? Because that record keeping, once you come into practice and in academics, you will do a lot of cases, and all the big cases you will be doing. But we need to know how good are you at record keeping? What's your attitude about the record keeping? It should be full. Even if it is an infection case, it should be full. What is the preoperative thing? You have to have a photograph of preoperative period with an X-ray, then operating, then post-operative. So it is basically to train you to have a full series of case, not half, that you have only intraoperative picture, you don't have any post-operative. You have only preoperative radiograph, you don't have post-operative. It is just to train you that you have to have full set of records with you. That's what we are looking at. Not the number of cases, not the cases what you are doing.
Bhagwan Das.
Yeah. Record, yes, definitely it's a part important aspect because we have to maintain a logbook. Logbook is there. Logbook gives a fairly good idea and an album augmented with it. So we can glance at a glance as teachers, we can make out like if it is corresponding with the logbook and the album. That is one aspect of it. And usually we try to tell, if they have seen variety of cases, put it as observed cases, assisted cases, and performed cases. So accordingly, the album also, if it is maintained that way, the observed cases, the assisted cases, and the performed cases. So then it becomes easier. So like how Ashish sir has spoken, so this categorization will help in knowing that how much he has worked, how much he's been exposed to, and how much is his competence. By seeing the case results, probably if we can ask that time one or two questions, probably we will come to know how much is his exposure also.
Very good suggestion. Very good suggestion that everybody should have three kind of albums. The case is done, observed, or assisted, so that you do not lie to the examiners. This, yes, I have only observed this case. I have assisted this case and I have operated on this case.
Yes.
Very good, fantastic suggestion from Bhagwan sir. Everybody should take it as.
Before I go to Shaji, Pritam wants to come in. Yes, Pritam, there's no force that can stop you.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I just want to ask the panelists, do you think if AMSA starts a registry and ask all students in the format what Bhagwan sir and Ashish was mentioning right now, to fill in and that be considered for all the exams? Do you think that's a possibility?
It's a good move. It's a very good move.
It can be definitely tried.
We'll have to discuss the integrities of that in a small committee because certain issues will crop up. I think it's a very good move.
What issues are you seeing, Shaji? What we are trying to tell now is, like, you know, every student, they'll enter their logbook in the registry. That will indirectly help us to get a registry to give a data to any time the government asks for, and the examiners will view through their login.
So Pritam,
but the thing is, we need to get the DCI compliance, and there are a lot of
why would we need DCI compliance for this?
You didn't get the point, Pritam. What happens is the institution, if you ask them to upload something. So ultimately, each institution is worried. From my institution, only 10 impactions this month has been mentioned. So we probably...
Well, sir, that's a point. That's a point. That's a point, sir, here. The point here is, this will be postgraduate registry. So what happens is, we are not looking at whether the institution has 100, 200 cases. We are looking at that particular member.
That was my question.
Who's a student.
That was my question, Pritam. Whether it is going to be postgraduate registry separate from the AMSI registry, which we are looking.
Rama, we are going off topic.
Pritam,
postgraduate registry.
That's good.
I think your idea is excellent. I think it is really good, but there are a lot of nitty gritties. I think we need to discuss it in the AMSI committee and bring it back because here the student, the forum is a little different. But your idea is excellent, Pritam.
We'll definitely look into it. And you know what? Sure. Mukul is going to scream at me for suggesting this. You know, while we were having a discussion last evening, you know, we need to have work in tandem for this particular event. Now, what came to our mind is, you know, there could be, I'm not going to deal it in detail at all, but we should have a separate a kind of a workshop, maybe online, offline, whatever, for the examiners too.
Exactly. See,
examiners. So we should have a workshop for examiners. Now this is, I'm just ending it here. We'll not discuss it. Preetam can
take. Students will get bored.
We continue with the webinar.
Can I continue on the records part?
Yeah. Shaji, one last word.
Yeah. Regarding records, the problem with records is most postgraduates, this is I'm addressing the postgraduates, especially the ones who are not writing exam now will be writing later. Most of the time, see, records are basically to show your ability to store things. It is for legal compliance. It is for your academic progress. You need to understand that. So it is not something to show to the examiners. It is something for you to train yourself on legal compliances and for the examiners. There are cases where, you know, people could have won a case easily if they had the photographs and the records and the prescriptions and all copied, which was not. This is an advice to the second years. When you start doing your record keeping, you need to start before you actually start touching the patient. You need to store the case history properly. You need to take proper pre-surgical photographs. You need to take the intraoperative photographs. You need to take the post-surgery follow-up photographs. You need to have the x-rays. You need to have the blood reports. All these needs to be compiled into a proper report. And if you can train yourself as PGs to maintain these records, many cases that are against doctors would have been solved. They do not have to go through the harrowing experience of going through the court. Bearing that in mind, when it comes to the exam, when it comes to the exam records, some of the places I have seen, some of you make very, very flowery record books. Okay. Record books are documents. I think Rama has shown some very good record book keeping. Probably it should be a folder system where you can keep adding things onto it, because if you've got a bound record book, the problem is later in your life, you'll never add anything to that. But if you have a flexible record book where you can keep adding data, you'll probably continue that experience.
Surely.
Okay. And examiners will be impressed by the fact that you have a continuous system of record keeping, and they, you know, just writing the story and binding something, it just becomes a book. I suggest that you keep it as a proper, a ring file system. Your name is written properly, no flowery things. It's considered as a legal document.
Okay, thanks. I think we'll go to the next point, that is the clinical examination for the minor surgery. Now, here we have a little issue because, you know, the DCI says that minor surgery, if I'm not wrong. Am I right, Bhagwan?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But then it differs from college to college whether, you know, like I think in AIMS, they do a submandibular incision. In most of the colleges, it's the third molar, the impacted mandibular third
99% molar. Of the colleges, the wisdom molar. Third molar surgery.
And of course, then episectomy. Now, Ashish, I would like you to weigh about, how you would tell the student to go ahead, beginning from the point of view of history taking.
Okay. We are talking about the minor surgery examination now, so it starts, evaluation starts from the attire what you are having. It starts from there because it is an evaluation exam. So it starts with the attire. You should be very well dressed, like scrubs and your gowns and everything. And then what we look at is the case. What is the case? Why you want to remove it or why you want to do the surgery, whatever it is, what investigations you have gone through, or what is your medical history of this patient. These are few things which are very important for us. And then if we take as third molar as the protocol here, prototype surgery, we take it as, and we would like you to know about the investigations, for example, your basic investigations like blood investigations, why you have gone for those basic investigations, then radiographs, exact evaluation of the radiographs, for example, war lines, your angulations, your inferior alveolar nerve canal, everything has to be evaluated and it will be asked in the Viva. Once you finish your case, then it will be asked to you. And then we look at the local anesthesia, how you are giving local anesthesia. These questions will be asked later on again about the local anesthesia. Where do you give local anesthesia? What is the composition which you were taking out? Which area you are giving local anesthesia? If it goes beyond, if it is not effective, all these questions will pop up once you finish your exam. And then we would like to see the incision, flap raising, bone guttering, tooth extraction, debridement, and then suturing. These are a few steps which we would like to see one by one. Some examiners, they say, okay, you start incision, reflect the flap, I'll come and see the reflected flap. Some stand there and see how you are taking the incision. And some, they will say, okay, you take your incision, raise your flap, we'll come and see that. Bone cutting and then extraction. And for us, for example, if I am the examiner, I'll see the retracted flap or reflected flap. And then I will see how you have extracted the tooth. And lastly, the suturing. And then post-operative instructions, your case sheet, your post-operative instructions along with your prescription. That is what I look at as far as minor oral surgery cases concerned.
Yeah, Mukul. If I can come in for a moment, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, if you can just throw some light on the war line tracing, where should it be done? Ideally, it should be on an OPG or an IOP. For the benefit of students, if you can show some light.
Answering that, right?
Yeah, I was going to mention something on something else. But yes, I feel an OPG, ideally it's an IOPA. War lines are supposed to be done on an IOPA. But it is important. And that's what I was trying to tell, addition to what Ashish said. I think planning of that particular surgery also gives we give a lot of importance to planning. How do you go about planning that particular, even if it's a wisdom molar extraction, how do you go about planning that surgery? Because it doesn't mean the technique which you are going to do, it may be totally different from the technique which I will do. You know, like there are different ways I will section a tooth. So just like there are many ways to skin a cat, it doesn't mean that one technique is better than the other. You should be able to justify why you're doing a particular technique and why you want to section a tooth in a particular way, etc. So this is what I feel. So planning also is equally important vis-a-vis the execution. And execution, you may falter also a little bit. You may want to section it in a particular way. It doesn't happen. It goes in another way. You may find difficulty or small root tip breaks. It doesn't mean that you're fail, or it doesn't mean that you get lesser marks. It doesn't mean that at all. We all, during surgery have to get different roadblocks, but we have to know how to negotiate them. So I feel, this is what I feel. It does, execution may not be exactly what you have planned, or you may go wrong, you may break a tooth the wrong way, you may leave, root pieces may find difficult, you may have some bleeding which you had not expected, but you don't need to get unnerved because of that. You can hold your calm. It doesn't mean that you'll get lesser marks for that particular.
Bhagwan, I have a question here which has come.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mukul. The question is that what happens if the tooth comes out without sectioning? We are not dealing with a simple mesoangular. Maybe it was a little difficult, but still, without sectioning, it comes out. This reminds me of an adage, which is there, I think, in Kruger, Mukul, if you remember. It says that the tooth belongs to the dentist and the bone belongs to the patient.
Exactly. See, we don't want the tooth in full, because in the treatment plan itself, if he has planned that, is there a locking or there is no locking in the tooth, he should be able to answer that, or he would have mentioned it in the part of it. So the whole minor surgery is, one is the written part of it and one is the skill of him. So both things are evaluated. In the written part is whether the case history has been noted, relevant points are mentioned, whether he has checked for the cheek flexibility, the mouth opening has been mentioned, the size of the tongue, whether he's mentioned it or he has noticed it, that is the observation part of it. The skill part of it is whether the incision has been put properly, the reflection, the tissue handling, the suturing, the removal of the tooth. Now, coming to the question of removing of the tooth, as you told, if he has planned that, if the examiner would have asked the question before starting the procedure, how will you take it out? And if you are told, I'll section and take it out, and then if he takes it out without sectioning the whole tooth, then the question comes, how was it possible? That means at the cost of the bone, there's removed good amount of bone, which he could have prevented. So this question comes. So without a favorable root pattern, still if he is able to take out the tooth in full. So that is the question. So in the treatment plan, what he has decided is the most important aspect.
Okay. Shahji, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm here.
Yeah, Shahji, one question, you know, what happens is that we get an OPG or maybe an IOPA, and then we find that the canal is very, the root apex is very close to the canal, right? So, what is your take on that? Because, you know, sometimes we say advanced imaging techniques. Have you got a CBCT done? So now, assuming that it's you know, close, a millimeter to the canal, what is your take? How should, in the event that there is no other patient available on that particular day, what would you do?
My take on that is, now we are creating oral surgeons. We are not, the whole idea of examination is to create oral surgeons and not to create examinees. Okay. So we are not looking at ideal scenarios. No oral surgeon is going to land up in an ideal scenario. The chances are that they will end up in less ideal scenarios. Now, suppose the patient does have the tooth close to a canal. What I would say is that the student should confidently do what is necessary to take up the case. Take the proper, what I will, if I would give full marks to a student who takes the proper consents, gives the proper consultation with the patient, advises the patient on the complications that are likely to happen with percentages, and then proceed with the case. I would give full marks because that really shows his clinical confidence and acumen. So that would be, there is no point in running away because it's an examination. For a surgeon, life is an examination every day.
Yes. Preetam says the bottom line here should be planning than anything else. That works for any surgery. Yes, yes, Ashish.
Yeah, that's correct what Preetam says. So in this kind of scenario, I would like the examiner to tell me that what steps he will take to prevent that. Not the radiograph, not the CBCT. It is the scenario, it is the situation he has. So how he is going to prevent it according to his skills. For example, that he has to do sectioning 1, 2, he has to change the arc of rotation so that it doesn't injure the inferior alveolar canal. So those kind of answers I would like to hear from the student. That, sir, these are the things, I'll try to do this so that it can be prevented. Not that I should have this radiograph or something like that. The scenario is there, he has to tell us what he will do that time.
And basically, like what Shahji said just now, you know, life takes an examination every day. So when I have seen many students lose their pool while removal of the third molar, they've done some excellent cases through the 3 years, but somehow, you know, I don't know whether
on the day of exam
intimidation that happens, despite the fact that, you know, nowadays we treat our students with kid gloves, you know, we pamper them so much, but despite that, the bottom line here is that you should be confident, right? It is just any other day, you know, like Shahji says, every day is an exam. So you're going to face exam maybe bigger than this in your life. So just be confident, work like it's any other day. Don't mind that the examiners are there, right? And I'm sure you will max it, right? So there was another.
I'd like to throw a little bone of controversy also.
Yeah.
When you look at the ethics of surgery, it says that when the surgeon feels that he is not ready to do a procedure, he should actually defer the procedure. That is, if you look at the Royal College's ethics, it says that when a surgeon is not ready to do or mentally prepared to do a procedure, he should not do it. So I don't know if other examiners will agree, but if my candidate was able to say that I am under tremendous pressure, and my pressure, the stress on me would jeopardize the patient. But I will go ahead to half the procedure and hand it over to somebody else. I would think that is right, because that is what you call as a judicial decision. But this should not be used on all examiners, because all examiners will not see eye to eye with what I think.
Yeah, there are some questions from Facebook also, which we'll take at the end. Okay. So I think I'd like to move
regarding on. Regarding the surgical removal, shall I add one word?
Yeah.
Students should in the case paper itself, they should mention the prescription what they are going to give.
Yes.
Because there will be a small discussion on the prescription, and the next post-op day, if the patient has to be recalled for a review, if at all the patient is recalled for a review, what will be reviewed in that patient when the patient comes on the next day after 24 hours? So that is should be there. And if at all the patient in some centers, if you are not calling or the examiner doesn't want to call the patient, in that case also you should be prepared to answer if there is a review, what all things you will look into. So this is another aspect of that impacted tooth removal.
Okay. Mukul, there is there is a question here. There are actually a couple which I may have to ask just now. We talk about planning, about tracing, and then we tell the student to do an index, whichever, Pedersen or Warfels or whatever. So how important are those? Mukul, if you could answer that.
A very honest answer, it's more important that they have an idea of the indices. And basically the indices should tell us the amount of difficulty which they anticipate while doing the extraction. I think that is what is only important. If I were to give it importance, they should be able to have an overview of them and give you a fair idea of the difficulty where they should anticipate while doing the extraction. That is the only importance I'll give it, not more than that.
Okay, now there is one tricky question here. How to answer for the controversies in treatment in exam? For example, if we go for immediate reconstruction or delayed reconstruction, open versus closed reduction. Now, open versus closed reduction is not a controversy. There are very few indications for closed reduction. But yes, this is just an example that this person has quoted. So, Rama, I need all the four people to come in because this does happen.
In fact, Rama, I just said the same thing, that there are many ways to skin a cat. I may do a surgery a particular way. Any one of the four other moderators or the panelists today will do the same surgery, will treat the same malady in a different way. So I think basically the student should be able to justify. It may not be in accordance with what the examiner feels also. Like even close reduction, close treatment, as you said, a particular condyle fracture, the student can justify close treatment also, as long as he is able to justify the reasons why he thinks, according to him, close treatment is the best option for that particular patient or a particular treatment modality which he is going to do. So it doesn't mean that if the examiner has a different view thought as to managing a particular deformity, the student has to have the same. I think they can differ as long as the student is able to explain his justification.
One word there. While answering these controversial questions or these things, the student should be confident, not overconfident.
Absolutely.
Overconfident will kill. Okay. So he should be confident enough to answer, but not to drag further controversy by his answers.
I have a tip for Indian examinees on the same topic.
Shaji, just 1 minute. 1 minute. Now, there could be a situation like what Bhagwan Das has said just now. There could be, the student could be so well read and that he would disagree with the examiner. Now, if there is a point over here, how do we get about doing it?
That is what I was just going to
Never answer. Disagree. Never disagree with the examiner, Rama.
Once again,
it is a very simple thing.
Indian scenario and the Western scenario on this. In the Western scenario, they would be happy that if you can defend your statement. But in the many of the Indian scenarios, the problem is the examiners are quite consider themselves quite learned. So what I would suggest is, I have seen in my experience of moving around is, students who are well-read may, if you have a point and you want to state the point and then listen to the next question that comes. If the next question that comes is trying to, dispute that, the best thing would be to leave the topic there. Don't get into an argument with the examiner.
Ashish,
other exams is a different story.
I will be very simple and straightforward that if I have read well, I know the things very well, but I'll put my point politely forward and leave it there only. So this is my way of
exactly
thinking.
Said, yeah.
I want to do it like this way. Then examiner says, no, it can be done by this way. Yes, sir, of course, it can be done by this way also. But I would like to do it in this way. And it has to be a very polite and very, very general kind of discussion, not something like argument kind of thing. Because if you have any tinge of argument in your tone or any sort of overconfidence in your tone, then it is going to tear you apart.
There is a point in in training, they call it state exit. You state your state what you think and exit, you leave. Okay, that is called state and exit. You stay at the point and exit, because there is no point in further pushing the matter and getting it deeper into an argument.
Shaji, two 30 seconds for you on this particular topic.
Pedagogy.
Yes.
Yeah. See, the whole idea of pedagogy is not to show your knowledge and ability and your in-depth knowledge of the topic that is given to you. Usually, it will be a very simple, small topic. And you are expected to spend 8 minutes in presenting and then answer questions for 2 minutes. Pedagogy is intended to see whether you have the teaching ability, because the MD program introduced in India was actually to make teachers, to create teachers of your subject. So it is to see whether you have the teaching ability. One more thing that the pedagogy does is to see whether you have the ability to reach out to the society, community, and patients. So you should be able to simply explain a topic that is given to you using literature. Okay, the quoting hi-fi literatures is not really required in pedagogy unless there is something new that you can exhibit. And you should be very crisp, clear. Your slides should not have more than 6 to 7 lines. Preferably, your slides should have more diagrams and less writing. And when you present the pedagogy, what I would say is, you should come prepared for the pedagogy to give the presentation extempore rather than reading it off the screen. Okay, reading it off the screen creates an impression that somebody else has made it for you and you're just reading it.
Sorry to interrupt.
Sure.
You coming in, Bhagwan Das. This is something that's your favorite. You have the to introduce the difference between pedagogy and andragogy.
Basically, see, out of my experience, I can say wherever when I go as examiner, this becomes an extended grand viva by and large. The pedagogy. Actually, see, pedagogy is a Greek word. Pedagogy means kids or by child. There, if you go by the term pedagogy, is art and science of helping the kid, and andragogy is andragogy or andragogy, whatever you call it, the art and science of helping adult learning, the kids learning and adult learning. So we are thinking kid learning. Kid learning is, you can make the interns or the junior PGs to sit there. This is not the first time they are doing the pedagogy. Pedagogy is part of their syllabus, which they are supposed to take a third year class. They are supposed to take a revision class or a final year student. At least 3 class is mandatory by the Dental Council. So they would have done, and the teacher would have pointed out certain things. It is not, most of the time what happens is the first time they would have been doing this in the exam day. So that is where the whole problem comes. So in the whole scenario, there is no questions asked on the particular topic. It's not a viva. Probably easy utilizing that 8 minutes. Or one, in that 8 minutes, has he sufficiently covered the relevant points which has to be conveyed particular to that particular topic which has been allotted to him? How well he has presented? Has he used any pictures? As like Dr. Shaji told, is he just reading it from the screen, or is he able to explain it? At the end, Is he going to evaluate the student, what he has conveyed, has it been reached? These are the steps which are seen. It is not that you are given a viva, you are given a topic on distraction, osteogenesis, what are the different types of distractions, what are the rectors, where all you will indicate. No, these are the things which are not going to be seen in pedagogy. Pedagogy is straight, it's the method and practice of, is he capable of conveying something to the juniors or is he capable of teaching? This should not be an by and large.
Bhagwan, thank you. Before I move to Mukul, I would like to take Ashish's opinion because I think he's already in an examination. So Ashish, a short take from you.
Pedagogy, Bhagwan Das sir has told everything about pedagogy. Simply, in 8 minutes, you have to explain a small topic. It doesn't need to be technical topic or anything. It has to be conveyed to the examiners that this is the thing which I want to say. And Shaji has already told that this slide should be with less material. You know, it should be 3 lines or 4 lines and the student should elaborate on those lines. That is how the speaker pedagogy should be there. And one or two questions, if examiner asks about the topic, it's all right, but not a viva kind of thing. But if it is one or two questions, that is all right, because examiner has all the rights to understand whether this is made by the student or not. That's it.
Mukul.
Yeah. I think everything is covered, Rama. Nothing different. Only
just
thing.
Just one last two points.
Yeah. The student who presents the pedagogy must preferably make it himself. Most of the time, the student tells the exam going student tells the junior to make it. You know, the second year or the first year to do it. So if at all that is done, the student who's presenting it must know the presentation well, and it's a test of how you actually talk or actually, you know, we want to nurture future speakers. So that is what entire pedagogy is about, how you're able to teach a particular subject. So that is what is important.
Okay. Now I'll go to the last part, that is the one, and I'll take Ashish only because he has some urgent commitments. So the last part of our talk is Viva. Ashish.
Yeah.
Before Ashish starts, actually, you know what Bhagwan Das said yesterday is that, you know, we need to do it in two teams so that, you know, there's no duplication or there is no, sometimes what happens is that there could be a difference of opinion between the examiners. So it's better to divide the topics into two groups, station A and station B, and then go ahead. So Ashish, your view on Viva.
Yes, Viva is, first of all, examinee should understand that Viva is not the only thing. That if you have not performed well in Viva, you will not pass. This thing you should take out from your mind first. Because in Viva, as we have already discussed, there will be difference of opinions about the treatment modalities. There can be different about the books you have read. There can be different, a lot of differences can be there. One thing is this. Second is you have to be very calm. Third is you have to answer well and fast. Do not have to wait for question that I'll wait or no, I'm thinking. And because this is your time which is going. You know, if you do not know a question, then you might ask the examiner that, sorry, sir, I don't know this question. Can we ask, can we go ahead? Or, sorry, sir, I don't know this. So, examiner will be able to ask you another question. Don't wait for a question for a very long time. But having said that, it doesn't mean that you will pass every question. So, I don't want to answer this. I don't want to answer this. No. Third thing is, you have to lead the examiner for the Viva, not to be led by the examiner. For example, if I'm asking a question on zygomaticomaxillary complex fracture, how do you treat this patient? So it should be in a very sequential manner. Sir, I'll do this, and finish it off there. Do not try to show your knowledge of a particular topic to examiner. This topic is my favorite. I have read quite about this topic, so I'll explain everything about it. No, just whatever has been asked, just answer that. Do not try to be smart with the examiners. They are double of your age. And they are more experienced, they are more smarter than you. You have to always think that your examiner is more smart than you. Maybe not in looks, but he can be smarter than you in thinking. because they have seen people like your examinees for a very long time. So always try to be very sweet, short, and particularly concentrating on the question which has been asked. Second thing, if you are asked for the references, then only give references. If you are not asked any references, don't try to give, sir, this book has said this, that article is saying this for this treatment. No way. You ask or you tell only what is asked. No references, nothing. This is what my take is on Viva, and it has to be a very calm way of putting up your views to the examiner. No arrogance is required here. If you know the things very well, don't have to be arrogant about it. No, I have read this. No, it is all right. Examiner must have read more than you. So you have to be very polite in answering the questions. And even in saying no, you have to be very polite. That's it, what I want to say about the why.
Shahji.
Yeah, actually.
Just hold on. Can I leave, Rama sir?
No, yeah. No, you can't.
Ashish, we won't hold you back. Only Mukul has got the final authority.
No, okay. No. Mukul sir, can I leave?
He's a taskmaster, this guy.
Mukul sir, can I leave?
You know who's the webinar coordinator, right?
Oh, Abhilasha ma'am, can I leave?
Sir, please, sir, please.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for being with
thank
us.
So much. Can I just share a small thing? Three slide PPT so that the students.
Shahji, then what I'll do is I'll come to you at the end.
Come to me at the end. Yeah.
You have some surprise, I believe. Yeah. Bhagwan and then Mukul. Dr. Bhagwan, you are muted.
Sorry, I muted. As you have already spoken that it has to be in two teams, the DCA also says it's a two team A and team B, one external, one internal, one external and one internal. The topics are divided. As per the council, if you go by the rule book also, a minimum of 40 minutes of an Viva has to be done. Even to each for 20 minutes, it will be 20 plus 20, 40 minutes for each candidate. So the topic, the division of the topic is usually beneficial because the student can be assessed on all the topics which has been covered or not. The general Viva will, the theory part of it, quarter will be instrument, which student should be aware of the instrument, that will be there. That can be radiograph, which again will be, and the general information of the paper. So the Viva is divided into four. Even when talking about theory, something basic, whether it is anatomy part or the general basic science, and then to the subject proper. That is how the question moves from basic to the maxillofacial surgery. And then you are answering, then it goes to the advanced level. So the basic competency is assessed. So that particular aspect, you should be thorough. Then at the end, is how much of an idea you have. So the student should be well prepared accordingly. So there is no compromise in not knowing the equipments and the instruments, especially the emergency drugs and the radiographs, which is there from the department. There cannot be any compromise on that. Then comes the theory part of it. Yes?
Bhagwan, I think
yeah. There
is some network issue with you.
Okay.
Yeah, now it's okay.
Am I audible?
Yes.
The earlier part, what I spoke?
Just the last few couple of sentences.
Yeah, that's what. So, as I told, it's into four parts. One is the equipments, emergency drugs, radiographs, and the theory part. Theory part also, it will be starting from the basics like anatomy or pharmacology, other things, then coming to minor oral surgery, maxillofacial surgery, and advanced surgery. So the Viva will distribute in that way. So the first three part, whether it is the equipment, the instruments, all these things, there is no compromise. So the student should be thorough with those things.
Okay. Mukul?
Yeah, a couple of things. I think they have already covered most of the point, but you know, this division of topic, one small thing I wish to tell the exam going students, most often than not, the examiner, if suppose I'm sitting with one more examiner and we have a list of 4 or 5 topics of which we are supposed to ask, very often the examiner asks the student itself, what have you read well? You know, this is an opportunity which students should seize. That means they, if they have read particular, most students, what they say, sir, everything. When they say everything, they are giving an, they are leaving the window open for the examiner to ask on everything. But if you have read, suppose, orthognathic better than the rest, then the students must open the mouth and say orthognathic and let the examiner talk on orthognathic surgery. That's one, I feel, way of leading the examiner, as Ashish was saying. And yes, you must lead your examiner to where you want to take them. The examiner, of course, knows this, that you're leading them, but they don't mind going that path just to know your particular knowledge. And the more you talk on a particular topic, the more marks you get. Secondly, I feel there's nothing wrong in saying, if you don't know something, if you have not seen a particular surgery, there are, you know, Maxfax surgery is very vast. Not all centers in the country do all types of surgeries. So if a particular surgery you're not well versed with, not seen, there's nothing wrong in saying, I've seen less of this, or we have not been able to expose much of this particular surgery. I'm sure the examiners understand that too. And if there is a particular thing which you don't know something about, don't beat around the bush. Be upright and say that, yes, forthright and say that, you know, I don't know much about this or whatever it is. You know? So,
yeah, one take here.
Yeah.
Mukul, if I can just come in. See, basically what we have observed as examiners is, you know, most of the students would, you know, they will prepare for the rocket science, how the rocket is launched, Mangalyaan goes, but they would not know how a rickshaw puller can draw the, cycle his rickshaw, draw the rickshaw, whatever. You know, so basically what happens is that the students are totally negligent about the basic part of oral and maxillofacial surgery. They would know so much about craniofacial surgery, but you ask something on dentoandibular surgery or trauma, whatever, which would be the basic bread and butter. You know, with that, when you have bread and butter, you can definitely go in for caviar, right? So,
yes. Secondly, also I feel, you know, somehow the students always feel the examiners want to trick them or fail them. Actually, it's opposite. The examiners want to make them talk on a particular subject and want to gain their knowledge. It's not, they don't want to know what they don't know. They want to know what they actually know about. You know? So it's difficult. You have to make an attempt to fail an MDS exam rather than an attempt to pass, I feel.
Correct. So, yeah, Shaji's got some surprise presentation.
No surprise.
Can you be quick about it?
It takes probably 5 minutes. It's just, can you allow
just,
me to share?
Just in the lighter vein, Rama, I remember a couple of BDS students writing, you know, their history where they don't write it clearly, you know, like if the patient is slightly pregnant, you know, we really don't know what is slightly pregnant. If patient is pregnant or patient has blood pressure, meaning patient is hypertensive, but they'll write blood pressure. So all such, of course, these are BDS level mistakes, but we should not be doing them at the MDS level.
Shaji, go ahead.
Anyway, since the whole program is called Face It, so I thought I'll just give a few tips. Basically, these tips will contain almost everything that was spoken in the last 1 hour. Okay, so let's get it. See, the first thing for exam in facing a viva, you need to be prepared. You're not prepared, then there is no point in coming up with any of the other things that we spoke about. So first thing is, how do you prepare? Number one, create topical indices. You know, when you come for a viva, you cannot read the entire book and carry your book with you. You should have indices that says, okay, trauma, these are the key points in trauma. These are the areas where, you know, people have controversies. We have those. Then pick up the niche points. There are certain fine things. Like, for example, when you talk about, you know, rigid internal fixation, you know, the niche points like gliding, spherical gliding principle, things, you know, that are niche that the examiners like to hear, that it shows that you have read in detail. You should pick up these niche points and keep it there. Second one is, it is always good to connect to the authors. Like, for example, the same thing I told you, when you talk about spherical gliding principle, it's always better to say, according to Spiegel, the spherical gliding principle. When you use that, the examiners are now looking at the person, you know, you will actually put the examiners on a back foot because they would feel that this fellow is really right. So one thing you need to remember, the person who is most knowledgeable at that point in that room is probably the candidate because he has just freshly read and come in. But the examiners have read probably a year back, 6 months, 3 months, 2 months back. They wouldn't have read the previous night. Okay, so the most prepared person in that room would be you. Please remember that. Okay, then combined study is a very good way to prepare for Viva because you are actually communicating by words. When you communicate by words to another person, it will become easy for you to communicate to the examiners. Another thing is you need to practice. When you do combined study, have practice Viva sessions so it builds up your confidence. Another one is have debates in that combined study groups so that when you debate with each other, you will learn that how to actually tackle people and how to convince people without actually going into a conflict situation. Another thing is appearances. You don't come totally looking disheveled. No examiner wants to see a person who just got up out of their sleep or a person who spent all their night sitting over books. No examiner or a patient wants to see a disabled person. No, nor do they want somebody who is overdressed. Okay, you don't wear your classiest wedding outfit and come. You should be dressed as a doctor should be. Okay, that's a big talk. I'm not going to give you this. Actually, a very big talk that I give to a couple of my students. I'm just going to rush through them. Now, the second thing is structure your answer. So once you've prepared, you need to have your answer structured. And these are structured well before the Viva. Like, pick up a, see, that's why I told you practice sessions. When you hear the question, don't jump an answer. Take that question, break it up into parts. Then what you need to immediately do is you need to do an immediate brainstorm, decide which part, how to talk. And then when you do the brainstorm, the question asked to you will have doubts in it. Clarify those doubts to the examiner. So the examiner asks you something, you can immediately ask, when you brainstorm, you can say, sir, is this what you want me to talk on? Then create a statement. Okay, don't just throw out everything that's in your mind as such. Don't vomit it out. Okay, before you speak, speak it in your mind and then present it. Organize your points into delivery points. It should not be one big story that you go once upon a time, long, long ago, not that sort of thing. Give delivery points. Plan jumps and redirects. Now, the problem is most examiners will trap you. Okay, they will bring you to a situation where you, you'll have to go face red. Okay, so plan these jumps and redirects because in every topic there will be jumps and redirects. So in trauma, you'll be able, when you come to a point, you should be able to find a way to trick the examiner into moving into cyst or something. Okay, brevity, be very short. I'm not very good at that. Okay, avoid arguments. Okay, be sure you don't have any argument things there. And always when you finish your exam, make sure you thank the examiner. And not just get up and say, thank you, sir, and walk off. Look them in the face and now that I'll talk in delivery. Number one, do not panic. Okay, if you go in there with a panic attack situation, you're inviting trouble. Second thing is maintain eye contact. Most of the times I've seen the examinees look down, their eyes are shuffling around. This actually creates in the examiner a mind impression that this person is not confident. You need to look confident. Now, I was in BHU and I was just telling the student, a surgeon, the mark of a surgeon is the fact that even if when he walks into the OT, he walks in with such a lot of confidence that the patient lying there thinks, oh, I'm in good hands. But if a surgeon walks into the OT looking like he's all trembling and scared, which we always are, okay, the patient would get up from the table and run away. The same story in the Viva. If you walk in trembling and shivering, it makes the examiner say, let me take him for a ride. So look confident, but don't look overconfident. Bhagwan Das said that don't look overconfident. Deliver slow, but don't drag. Some people just shoot it out. Don't do that. Deliver, give your delivery slow, but don't drag it. Don't drag it. Do not ramble. Beating around the bush is rambling. Don't ramble around. If you're not sure, be honest. Say, sir, I really do not know this. I'm sorry. And do not slump. Some people sit with a slump. like, you know, the whole world weight is on my shoulder. I've been carrying all the books on my shoulder. Do not slump. Sit erect. Sit straight. One of the things is when you sit straight, your mind works better. There's a lot of psychology. I'm not going to touch that. Okay? And start with a statement. When a question is asked to you, don't just start, in a rambling manner. Start with a statement. The question is asked, start with the statement. And then try to defend the statement or give up. That's why I said, get ready to jump and run. Okay? Use of hands. Don't keep your hands folded on your lap, on the chair, holding the chair, holding the table, or, drumming around, moving your fingers around. No. Your hands should be there to express what you're trying to speak. Because nonverbal communication is very important. It has a lot of effect on the examiner. Use jumps and redirects as needed. You need to understand where, as the examination goes on, you need to, that's why I told you, because you've already planned, you need to know this is going into very bad, deep waters. I need to, move the thing towards shallow waters. You need to probably give up an answer so that, the examiner shifts. Because if you keep answering at that point, you will end up in deep waters. State controversy, yes. There are certain areas where there are controversies and the examiner may, start, is it so? At that point, state the controversy and withdraw. It is called state and exit. Don't say anything anymore. Don't say, sir, I'll show you my this article. You had it. Okay? Then, remember, most Mukul said it very beautifully before me. Remember, most examiners want to pass you. Failing is your choice. Okay? Thank you very much, Rama, for this little time. I hope it was useful. I just summed up what we all spoke about the whole time.
Can I make a point? One small point?
Sure. And then we'll have Preetam coming in. Huh?
Yeah, on what Shaji said, I like it that, always start with a statement, because we also have seen number of students, and I had a student who had a question about when you're asking a question, he used to counter question. That means, how do you treat condylar fracture? His next, sir, unilateral or bilateral? I mean, he'll ask the examiner a question. So don't do that. You assume whatever question you're asked, you start with an answer and don't counter question the examiner to get more out of that particular thing. So this is just, I just remembered what
Counter question and clarification is different. Don't try to over clarify.
Yeah, Bhagwan, and then I'll get Preetam into this.
Bhagwan is not in good range.
Can you hear?
Yeah,
am I audible? Yeah. Okay. That is, the tip is the brand by on the skin.
Answer.
Hello.
Hello. But
he's frozen.
Hello, audible.
Your hellos are very clear, but the rest is not.
Bandwidth is
okay. Some network issue, I believe. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, I'll try to speak louder. On the first day, there will be certain questions which they would not have answered in interaction or in the case discussion. While coming, students should be prepared for the unanswered questions of the first day. They might be asked or might not be asked. If it is asked and if still they don't know, that will be a negative impression on the examiner. In the same way, the theory questions also, most of the places there will be correction of the theory paper also, which would have taken place. It might be of their own center or from the different center. Examiner idea what type the answers have been. The student should see to that, even though he has not written in the theory paper, he should be prepared with all the answers of the theory questions.
Yes. Preetam, can you come in? Hello, Preetam? Preetam?
Preetam is muted. Shall we ping him and see? Why don't you ping him?
No, I poked him.
Rama, you can ask one of the, Dr. Dabir is there, Suresh Menon sir is there. If they can do add something, it will be a help to the students,
Yes,
The answer is there.
Dabir sir.
Dabir sir, I can't see him here.
Yeah, you can. Ashok's iPad.
Yeah, okay. Hi.
Yes, sir.
Hi, sir.
Right. Ask one of the current examiners. See, I'm now, I'm no more an examiner. Sir, you're a seasoned examiner. I think you should.
Sir, you're an examiner of examiners.
Yeah. Yeah, I think all of you have said it. Shaji has given a beautiful three-slide description. Whole thing is we read. I like Bhagwanda is that point that whatever theory you have written, please go through your answers because you might get a chance to correct any answer if you have made a mistake or you are not adequately answered. You might get a chance. Back to basics. Your basics should be sound. Examiners never are okay. Teachers may vary.
Oh, somebody's marching. Pritam, can you come in?
Pritam just marched in. Now he's silent.
Suresh Menon, sir, are you there? Pritam, go ahead.
Hello. Yeah, sir, I got a phone call in between. I missed.
Okay.
I missed your conversation because I had to go to receive a call.
Pritam, why don't you keep your video on? We'd like to see you. I think the kids should also see you. Yes.
No, you wanted to say something, Pritam, that's why.
Yes, Pritam.
No, no, I don't want to say anything.
Okay. Is Dr. Menon there? Dr. Suresh Menon? I'm not very sure.
Chennai sir, if you really want me to say, yeah. I have a clue for the students if they don't answer for this year.
Yeah.
Pritam.
All they have to do is they have to cough.
Sneeze is even better.
But that won't be helpful for the online examiners, I guess.
That's
another
one. Bhagwan. The student should take the mask.
Yes.
Yes, Divan sir.
Yes, I wanted to add one thing.
Please, sir.
For the examiners,
yeah.
Whosoever examines the candidate, try to find out what the person knows. Not that the candidate, what he does not know. You know, he has spent all these 3 years. He had been studying sincerely for that. But we as an examiner try to find out what the person does not know. That is not true. I think we should encourage the person to say something which he really knows in detail also, in addition to whatever query we have.
Yes, sir.
Right, sir.
Huh? Totally agreed, sir.
Okay.
In fact, about spoken.
Thank
about
you so much, sir, for your input. Mukul, and Shaji, you know, there was a complaint from Facebook. I think this was pertaining to that particular incident which we discussed right in the beginning about an operated case. So let us exclude TMJ ankylosis from that. Now just get back. We'll just take 30 seconds from you all. If there is an operative case for a long case history, please tell us what to do. Let us exclude.
There was a discussion. By and large, all major case or minor case would have been a called case, appointment-based cases, because these patients have been scheduled. Either they are in the ward or they would have been called on that particular day for exam. It is not just a walk-in case by and large during the exams, even if it is a major or minor. Thing is, if it is an operated case, all the investigation reports, radiographs, everything will be available. Including if it biopsy report, if it is a pathology, this will be there. The student should ask the department people, whoever is allotting the case, these all findings. Most of the time what happens is they would have taken the case history, they would not have operated case only, they would not have kept the investigation report or for that matter biopsy report, or they would not have asked what was the aspiration which had come in case if it is a cyst case. So this information has to be taken, though if it is a defect, also post-operative defect, which will be discussed later. But these points has to be taken into account. Not necessarily if it is a non-operative case, like need not have to go for an aspiration on that day of the examination by the candidate. He should know If he is aspirated, if it is in the differential diagnosis, probably he should be able to tell. If it is this particular cyst, I would expect this particular type of an aspiration. If it is a pathology or if it is a vascular lesion because of the swelling, if it is there, I will anticipate these things. So on the day of examination, we don't want him to do some intervention like aspirating or doing a biopsy there. That is not expected. But if it is an operated case, these findings, he has to collect it from the department or from the internal.
Okay. Mukul, 30 seconds from you.
I think the internal should tell what exactly he wants from the student, whether he wants to see the preoperative position and discuss on that, or he just discusses on the particular case post-surgery. That is what is important. I think otherwise, Bhagwan, sir, has covered everything.
Shahji?
Yeah.
Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, Shahji, there's one question which comes up repeatedly, saying that is there any book for different case history formats? I don't think so.
No, but there is no book. The best thing that you can go is for the Hutchinson's manual or the Harrison. There is nothing as such. You can take Mary and Love, even A.K. Das. Das and Das also has case history format. How to examine a swelling, how to examine an ulcer, how to examine. Basically, you need to gather all that together and then put it together. There is no book as such, but I think it should have, case history taking should have become a habit over the 3 years in which you've been studying. Because you've already been presenting case discussions as 5 case discussions minimum per year. So if you've done 15 case discussions, I think you should have already know how to examine. And there are books that give you, I think Das and Das gives you on how to examine swelling, ulcers, lymph nodes, all that examination points are given there.
Okay. I think this is something, you know, that has come from who's not an examiner, I mean, who's not an examinee. But, you know, when we deal with the minor surgery, dentoalveolar surgery, is there a role of dexamethasone or a steroid? Let us say a steroid. That depends. So should we give a single dose steroid to the patient? And should we recall him the next day?
Looking at it in two ways. One is the clinical aspect. Of course, a lot of study was done on that area. And people have found their reports that, you know, the immediate post-operative swelling is reduced. And your anti-inflammatories work, and there are some controversies also there. That is for a academic discussion. As far as the student is concerned, if he gives dexamethasone, there is nothing wrong in that. He should be able to defend himself as to why he has given it. He should be able to tell the examiner, this is the rationale on which I have given it, and yes, these controversies do exist, but this is what I believe. And he should also be able to explain to the examiner the next question that's going to come to him is the whole question on corticosteroids and its use and its effects are going to come. He should be prepared for it.
Yeah. Mukul and final word by Bhagwan, and then I'll give Mukul.
Yeah, I think he already spoke. Depends on center to center and depending on case to case. He should know the effect of the steroid. He should read out about the dosage. What are the side effects, how short a dose he should give, all these things he should know, and then he should be able to justify his reason.
Bhagwan Das?
If it is a department protocol, it depends on center to center, as it has been told. If it is a department protocol is there, that this has been followed regularly, on that particular day, he need not have to change. He said, regularly we follow, this is the department protocol, and it has to be given. At the same time, he should be prepared, like why it is given, there will be a question which he should anticipate. Suppose if steroid is avoided, if it is there any alternative for this edema control? So he should be able to defend that things because he might anticipate these questions.
Yes.
And he should be prepared for it.
Thank you. So I think I'll...
Contraindications, where you can't give steroids, all these things he must know.
Abhilasha?
Yeah.
Abhilasha?
No more questions from Facebook.
I think basically we've dealt with that. There were some specific topic pertaining questions which we'll deal in some future webinars if Mukul permits. So need to have them. So I'll just wind up. by saying that, you know, as Dr. Diwan has said, that we have been observing the student for 3 years, right?
Yes.
Student has been working sincerely, honestly. I don't see that whether there should be any fear for the student to appear for the exam. It is just any other day. There could be bigger exams which life takes, and I'm sure that everybody is going to do well. So when you are dealing with your case history for both long and short, stick to the relevant points. Don't ramble, right? Don't waste your time because you've been given a specific time period, right? When you're dealing with, of course, which is the first part actually, when you're dealing with dentoalveolar surgery, work very confidently, right? The incision, the tooth delivery, the sectioning and the tooth delivery should be proper. The examiners are not there to harass you, but just to observe you, because we need to observe you during the examination, right? In many centers, it is done that people would be standing there. So there's no need to fear. Otherwise, Sachin Tendulkar would not have hit hundreds, double hundreds and triple hundreds if 67,000 people were not doing it, right? So make sure that you work confidently. Any part of the practical examination, the case history taking, the minor surgery, and even the viva. So for the viva, Shaji has given beautiful points, right? That you need to be properly dressed, be confident. A pedagogy is to check your teaching skills. It's not a viva on that particular point. However, there could be something whether you understood or not, because you can always outsource it to your juniors. So you need to be very sure about what you're speaking. And one thing very importantly, whenever you are making a presentation, whether in pedagogy or in future seminars, webinars, conferences, it should have minimal text. It's not like just photocopying a textbook and reading it out there, right? Mm-hmm. So be confident. Sir? Yes.
Please carry on.
Yeah, you interrupt.
I'll come in.
So that is about it. I'm sure that you're not going to cough on the exam this year, as Pritam gave it. Because the examiners would be even smarter, they might come with 2 and 95 marks, right? There's one last question before.
If I can just come in. Sir,
just one minute. There's one, Dr. Akshu says that any changes in performing minor surgical procedures, vis-a-vis aerosol. Bhagwan Das?
Yeah, everybody should be aware in the present condition, donning and doffing of PPE. When I talk about PPE, it's PPE. Because a mask with the face sheet is also PPE. I mean to say coverall also. Coverall, shoe cover, head cap, PPE mask, FFP2 mask, R95. Everything. It's a standard PPE. Everything should be there and he should be donning, doffing should be perfect. Then it depends on what of the particular center is taken permission and which will be executing for the minor surgery. Not necessarily an impaction has to be done, because some places probably a relaxation might be there.
Mukul?
Yeah, I think in the present scenario, one is you must read a little bit about the corona as well as the COVID. And yes, donning and doffing of PPE, must make sure that you do all the precautions which you do while doing your minor surgical procedure. I think that is important.
Yeah.
Abhinasha,
is there a question?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
No, sir. I just wanted to stop. She was telling you to stop.
No, sir. I just wanted to add about donning and doffing. That point is well covered, sir. I just wanted to add that. In the present scenario, the students, they should know about the donning and doffing.
Okay. Is Brinda there?
Yeah, I can see her.
Can I share my screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, Shrinath sir, I'm there.
Yeah, so Brinda is the treasurer of our academy. She's busy with an examination, so she keeps on and off, but she's done a great job. Yes, please share.
Yes, sir.
Brinda looks rich.
So Brinda is all the money where the money is.
Yes.
Yeah.
So from today we start our session season 3. This is CIMS webinar team. We had a wonderful session, especially for the postgraduates today. Thank you very much, all the panelists, for being with us today. upcoming webinar, it will be on 27th July, 11 a.m. It will be on practical approaches in the management of odontogenesis. This will be by Dr. Janardhan Gadde. Please do join us. And this is again regarding the social media page or details of our CIOMS. This is a QR code for the CIOMS YouTube channel. Please subscribe and don't forget to hit the bell icon so that whatever videos are being uploaded, you'll be notified. And please don't forget to like our Facebook page as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Abhilasha. I will reshare now the last leg, right? And we thank all the panelists. Thank you so much, Dr. Bhagwan Das, Mukul, Chaji, and Ashish. Thank you so much. We value the inputs given by the seniors, Devan sir, Dabir sir, Preetam was there, Dr. Menon had joined, and so many more actually, and the audience who are always there for us. Thank you so much. And this is a small task that we do. Abhilasha, could you take a screenshot, please?
So, yes, sir.
Thank you, Ashish, for this. We will be mailing it to you very soon, right? Bhagwan Das, you have come again on our platform. So thank you. Bhagwan Das was there a few days back for us. Mukul Pate. Is that you, Mukul?
Yeah. Yes, sir. So.
You could have fitted better to the screen.
Mine is photograph is the worst. Abhilasha has been mean to me. There is some this I know.
You only sent me that photo.
This is Shaji's matrimonial photograph. So thank you.
First, second or third?
He's trying to scare the corona.
Rama, one question I have.
Yeah.
How many seasons are there?
Abhilasha is going to answer that.
There are four seasons in India.
this is the last season, but how many webinars in this season that Rama sir will tell you?
Are you
Mukul,
sure?
Sir.
This is like those web series, Rama. It is like those web series, you know.
It never ends.
Mukul sir,
this is going to go on Netflix.
Depends, Mukul sir, depends on when the vaccine will affect on Rama sir.
We have to
not
pay
vaccine availability. It should have effect on him.
People are addicted to this web series.
So much. We really value your presence over here, and of course, special thanks to my webinar team. I only talk; they do the work. So thank you so much for being there.
Great job,
thank you so much, sir.
Congratulations,
great.
Good job.
Keep talking.
Because Abhilasha.
But I like the way Abhilasha sent you the message to stop talking. Huh? She just interrupted you and said.
She sent to everyone.
Keep talking.
She's sending to Rama sir. She sent to everyone.
Yeah, she sent to everyone.
Mukul, your student Hirkani has said awesome to you.
She
didn't say
that.
There are many compliments on the Facebook as well.
Oh. Yeah.
A similar session for examiners also.
Did. Do you guys want Mukul sir to do one more talk? Why are you praising him much?
Not at all.
Abhinash had to get Mukul because I called him so many times, he never picked up my calls also. But one
same
thank
here.
You, Mukul, sir.
Same here.
Rama, Abhilasha is Abhilasha. Rama is Rama.
Yes.
There is a difference or not?
The problem with Mukul is where is his apron even in his house? So it's difficult to pick up the call.
So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rama.
Bhagwan sir, that look of yours reminds me of Mitai shop.
Virappan.
Okay.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.